Welcome back. In this module, we will discuss the biosafety risk assessment. As we mentioned before, in the risk characterization and evaluation module, that the risk assessment process is divided into two parts, the biosafety risk assessment and the biosecurity risk assessment. In this module, we will discuss the biosafety risk assessment in more details. This material has been adapted from Sandia National Laboratories. In this module, we will discuss the biosafety risk assessment as an analytical process that consists of risk characterization, which is the identification of the hazards to determine and determining the likelihood and the consequences of undesirable events, and determining the level of risk, and the risk evaluation process, which is decide if the risk is accepted or not, usually the risk evaluation process is an intermediate step between risk characterization and risk mitigation. The biosafety risk assessment is an analytical process to determine the relative level of risk that the activities in the institution or in the laboratory has, and also to determine what are the appropriate mitigation procedures to put in place. A biosafety risk assessment should consider every activity and procedure or practice that we usually do in the lab. And that means that we need to consider all aspects of the operations, the materials, the equipment used, and what are the types of the pathogens and toxins used during our work. When do we do the biosafety risk assessment? Usually we must do the biosafety risk assessment at the beginning of any work or when any changes happen. For example, if we are handling a new infectious agent, or if there's an outbreak, or if we are handling a new animal model, we need to do a risk assessment process. In case also of changing the procedure or practices, or purchasing a new equipment, or adding new procedure, or any modification to the procedure, we need to do the risk assessment process. Also, in case of changing the employees, or having students or visitors at our institution, we need to assess the risk. In addition, we need to do the risk assessment in case of outbreak or laboratory acquired infection or any accidents happen. What is the objective of the risk assessment? The main purpose of the risk assessment is to determine the likelihood and the consequences of the risk and to decide what are the appropriate mitigation measures that should be taken. But there are other benefits of doing a biosafety risk assessment. For example, the biosafety risk assessment results could help us to allocate resources to mitigate the risk, and also it helps us in the planning for the training events and to determine what are the requirements and needs of the employees, and for example, what are the appropriate PPE to purchase, or what kind of training they need, if they need, for example, a training in waste management or the decontamination or in any other procedures. It also helps us to evaluate the compliance with the national, international, and institutional regulations, and help us also to justify the space and equipment needs, and to evaluate the emergency and incident plans. The risk assessment process is defined as a procedure that analyzes the hazards, the situation, to determine the likelihood and the consequences by gathering information about the agents and about the procedures to determine the relative level of risk. And always we can represent risk on the likelihood and the consequences graph. We can define the risk as a likelihood of undesirable event and the consequences of this event. And we can also define risk as a function of likelihood and consequences. In laboratory biosafety, we always focus on unintentional adverse events that could happen. For example, in case of a spill, we need to do a risk assessment. Or in case of any of the staff get the infection in an unintentional way, we need to do a biosafety risk assessment. In the biosafety risk assessment, we need to focus on the agents, pathogens that we are using, and also we need to consider the procedures and gather information about the procedures. The risk characterization is the actual process of the likelihood of determining the likelihood and consequences of risk assessment. And when we do the risk assessment, or we have to be sure that we are assessing the very specific risk. We can't do a risk assessment for risk in general. We need to be very specific. There are a number of factors that we need to gather information about them and to consider them when we are doing the biosafety risk assessment. And we will focus on two major factors, the agent factors and the procedures factors. In the agent factors, we need to consider the hazard. And in the case of biosafety risk assessment, the hazard is the biological materials or toxins that we are handling. And we need to collect information about, for example, the incubation period, the infectious dose, the route of exposure, and the route of infection. And also, we need to gather information about the pathogenicity of the infectious agent, which is the ability of the agent to cause a disease, or the virulence, which means the degree of pathogenicity. And also, we need to know the host range, whether it's human or animal or plants, and the communicability of the disease, if it's epidemic or not, and also the transmission means and routes, whether it's transmitted by inhalation, ingestion, or direct contact. And also we need to know the environmental stability and any other important factors about the infectious agents. Regarding to the procedures, we need to gather information about the type of the procedures that are done. For example, are we doing the PCR, or are we doing the bacterial culture, or antibiotic testing, or for example, DNA sequencing, or any other biochemical testing? Are we using radioactive materials or carcinogenic materials? We need to collect information about the procedure. And what also about the equipments? What are the equipments used? Are we using autoclave? Are we using centrifuge, biosafety cabinets? And what are the possible risk of these equipments? Also, we need to collect information about the training level of the employees and if it's enough for them or if they need any more training. And about the dangerous procedures and the consequences of the procedure that we are doing. And also about the waste management and the decontamination processes and any other processes done in the lab. Now we will discuss scenarios about the biosafety risk assessment. In the first scenario, suppose that you are working with a seasonal influenza virus conducting aerosol challenge studies on animal hosts with a little respiratory protection. We need to answer the following question. The first question is, what is the likelihood of exposure? And to answer this question, we need to consider some factors. The first factor is the type of the virus. We are working with a seasonal influenza virus, which is transmitted by inhalation, and it is easily transmitted. And also we need to consider the concentration and the volume of the virus and the type of the experiment. And here in this scenario, it seems that the activity generates aerosols, so which increase the likelihood of exposure. And also about the procedure, the employee here in this scenario is wearing a little respiratory protection. All of these factors increase the likelihood of exposure, which means the likelihood of exposure here is high. The second question is the consequences. What are the consequences of exposure? And here we need to consider the type of virus and the vaccination and the treatment. The type of virus here is not dangerous. It's caused usually a flu-like symptoms, and it's a seasonal virus, so many people are vaccinated, and even if they are not vaccinated, it's not dangerous unless they are immunocompromised. So the consequences in general in this scenario is low. So the overall risk is a combination of likelihood and the consequences, and here the overall risk is low. In the second scenario, you are working with a wild-type Ebola virus in a high-containment BCL4-type laboratory, inoculating large number of mice with varying concentrations of virus to determine the lethal dose. The first question is, what is the likelihood of exposure? And also here we need to consider the factors in this scenario. The first factor is the type of the virus. And the Ebola virus, as we know, is transmitted by inhalations, which increase the likelihood of exposure. The second factor that the type of the activity. They are inoculating large number of mice, which means that they are using needles. And there is a high likelihood of needle stick. And also the third factor is the number of mice. They are inoculating large number of mice, which increase the likelihood of exposure. So the likelihood of exposure in this scenario is high. The second question, what are the consequences of exposure? As we know that to determine the consequences, we need to consider the type of the virus. And the type of virus here is Ebola is a high risk virus. So the consequences are high. And as we know, there is no vaccine, no treatment, and the fatality rate is 90%, so it's high. So the overall consequences are high. And even though that we are working in the BCL4 containment lab, but that does not mean the risk will be low. So the overall risk here is high. Usually, to do a risk assessment in our laboratories, we need to do many of these scenarios. We need to be very specific and collect factors related to our work, to our pathogen, to determine the likelihood and the consequences and represent them on a graph. And to do a facility-wide risk assessment, we need to gather all of the information and collect all of these scenarios together and to do like a comprehensive risk assessment process. The biosafety risk assessment in general started with defining the situation by identification of the hazards, gathering information about the host and the pathogens, and determine the level of risk. And by defining the risk and characterizing the risk by determining the likelihood and the consequences, then we have to do the risk evaluation, which means to decide if it's accepted or not. If it's accepted, we can proceed with our procedure. If not, we need to implement more mitigation measures. And after implementation of mitigation measures, we need to evaluate them again and reassess them again. The risk evaluation process is an intermediate step between risk characterization and risk mitigation. Here in this process, we interpret the results of risk characterization to determine the level of risk and to decide if the risk is accepted or not. And as we said before, the risk evaluation process is a subjective process. For example, if two institutions have the same computed risk, if they are doing the same risk characterization process, both of them maybe have the same level of risk. But when we come to the risk evaluation, each one of them could evaluate the risk in a different way. One institution could consider the risk high, and the other one could consider the risk low or medium. So the risk evaluation result is usually different according to the institution, to the individuals, and the community. Please do the risk, the assignment, and follow up with the discussion. Thank you.